want to talk about coming full circle. Many of you know, I was homeless when I was diagnosed HIV positive, and homelessness lasted for 29 months. 14 of those 29 months, I was HIV positive. I think a lot of people think that I became HIV positive and then homelessness. I was already well over a year into homelessness when I was diagnosed HIV positive. My first encounter with APLA, AIDS Project Los Angeles, it wasn't a positive one. It just wasn't. There was a lot of red tape. There was a lot of, you need to be patient. There was a lot of, oh, it's a process. Just wait. I remember twice sitting in the lobby begging for help. And the last time I walked out, just in tears, I sat there for about 30 minutes just crying. And I didn't care who saw me cry. I just cried. I bawled. When no one came to say, hey, what's going on? I just got up and I left. On the corner of APLA, there's a church. I think it's a Roman Catholic church, and it's usually always open. And I just remember crying. And I got to the corner and I started to walk to the train, and I looked towards the church and I saw that the doors were open. And I was like, you know what? I'm just gonna go in and I'm gonna pray. And as I started walking up the steps and going in, I think it was a nun, if I remember correctly, asked me if everything was okay. And she kind of put her hand on my back and everything to try to calm me down. And I just told her, I said, I just want to pray. And I kind of walked past her and I sat, I think it was like the third or fourth pew in, and I pulled the little rest down and I just kind of like put my head down like this and I just prayed. And I didn't care that it was quiet in there. I didn't care that I'm supposed to be quiet. I needed to have God hear me. And I just cried. I said, please, I need some of this load lifted. Right now, I need some of this load lifted. The next day, Tiana called me. That's the case manager that I was assigned to. And it was not a nice phone call. I was pissed off that it had taken so long to get to her, that no one helped me when I was there. And I'm gonna be honest, I was an asshole. But my first meeting with her, she apologized. She was so professional and so nice. And she had already come up with like a game plan and everything, and we sat down and we discussed what the game plan was. And it's partly because of her that I am where I am today. It's partly because Brian, the AIDS treatment educator, that I am where I am today. They treated me with respect. They didn't treat me like a statistic or like some case study. They treated me like a human being. I can't speak for anything else but how my relationship is with them and how much I am so thankful that God put them in my path. How I am so appreciative and thankful and humbled by them being in my life. It seems that everybody who is in the arena of homeless services or HIV services, you have to fit this cookie. It's like this cookie cutter, and there's 12 different cookies, and you have to fit into one of those molds. It may not be 12, it may only be 2, it may only be 1, it may be 52, but you have to fit a mold. And anything outside of a mold, no one knows what to do. Tiana and Brian knew what to do. They treated me like a human. They treated me like a real live person in front of them. Not some statistic, not some graph, not some study, not some poor, pathetic homeless person with HIV. They treated me with respect. And they tried to identify what my needs were, and they tried to help me get the services that I needed. I remember Brian telling me, he was just like, you don't do anything bad. You just want people to be accountable. And I remember when he said that, because another social worker had just told me what an idiot I was. How me thinking I could help somebody was so stupid. And I remember all the hardships that I had prior to that. And here is Brian, the AIDS treatment educator, telling me, you're not saying anything bad and you're not doing anything bad. You just want people to be accountable. And that's all I've ever wanted, for people to be accountable, for organizations to be accountable. Everything looks perfect on paper. We can make everything look as pretty as a peach cobbler right out the oven, but it may taste like a bitter piece of shit when you bite into it, or when you actually show up for the services. It's one thing to have something on paper, but it's something totally different when a person is actually presenting and they need those services. You need to be able to deliver those services. Tiana and Brian not only delivered the services, they were my friends. I didn't hesitate to call either of them when I reached my darkest points. I didn't hesitate, because I knew I wasn't going to get lectures. I knew I wasn't going to be told, oh, you did this. Oh, you shouldn't have done this. Oh, you bad, bad person. Oh, da 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 da. They were just like, okay, so what? How do we move from here? How do we fix this and move forward? How do we get you into an apartment? Let's get you into an apartment. I heard so many people say, Kenji, I want to fix it for you. Brian and Tiana were always like, let's fix it. Not just for you, but let's just fix it so no one else has to deal with this. That's always been my goal. No one should have to go through what I went through. No one should have to fist fight for things that belong to them. No one should have to tell a case manager, I don't want to go there because I fight. And that case manager's response was, oh, just give it one more shot. When you know I was in the emergency room. That should never be a response. Oh, just give it one more shot. In other words, fuck you. When you tell somebody to give it one more shot, when you know they're in harm's way, what you're saying is, you don't matter. Fuck you. I never got that from Brian or Tiana. If I said I didn't want to do it, or if I said, when I ran into the problems with Project New Hope and telling the manager what was going on, the drugs in the room, the one guy that was pushing me and hitting him would be like slapping my grandmother. I was just like, and if I hit him, then all bets are off the table for me. When I told Tiana, I was like, I'm going back to the streets. I'm not going to stay here and allow. And she was just like, okay. She was just like, I understand. Okay. Because if I hit him, then I'm the bad guy. And all bets were off the table. This apartment would have been off the table because I hit somebody. Not because I just wanted to hit them. They were pushing me. They were putting me in harm's way. And you can only push me so far before I respond. So I had to think about that. And then I was just like, you know what? I'm better off on the streets. Better off on the streets. Tiana didn't make me feel bad about that decision. She didn't say, oh, I think that's bad for you. When I nearly settled and accepted less than from Skid Row Housing Corporation, the first thing Tiana said to me was, Kenji, are you sure? And I was just so nearly broke that I was willing to accept something that Tiana knew was not going to last. Because once I realized that this is not something that's going to work for me, and it is not something that should work for anyone, she knew that I would be like, Tiana, we gotta find another place. And she was like, are you sure? She's like, if that's what you want, and I thought about it, and I talked to my friend Natalie, and my friend Natalie saw the apartment, and she was just like, you could sleep in my back seat. I don't think you should take that. You can sleep in my back seat. Eventually, it all worked itself out, and they canceled my housing through there anyway because I have a big mouth. I'm a rebel rouser. I'm a troublemaker. I stick up for people. I'm saying all that to say this. Tiana and Brian saw the best in me when everybody else saw homeless person, worthless person, HIV person, poor person, rebel rouser, troublemaker, backwards thinker, ignorant. When everybody saw that, they saw the best in me. And they made sure I continued to see the best in me and that I continued to believe in myself. Because of Tiana and Brian, I am in this apartment. Because of Tiana and Brian, I have an amazing doctor and an amazing care facility. The best. And because of Tiana, I got to go to AIDS Watch in DC. And today, I got to go to APLA once again. And I was interviewed by a girl named Tanya for The Optimist. It's their online magazine. And I remember walking out of APLA, and if I haven't said this, APLA is AIDS Project Los Angeles. I remember walking out of APLA, and these just feelings just started to overwhelm me. And by the time I got to the corner, I started to cry again. And this time it wasn't because I was confused or that I needed God to fix things. I needed him to lift some things. I was crying and I was overwhelmed because I started thinking about where I was 2 years ago when I went to APLA in 2008. Thinking about what my mental state was. Thinking about all the case managers and all the shit I had to deal with. I just wanted to go inside and thank God. So I started going up the steps again. And I went inside and I sat probably in the same row I sat in and I cried. And I just said, thank you. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you for putting Tiana and Brian on my path and preventing me from self-destructing. Preventing me from giving up. Thank you. Thank you for letting me keep my mind. That was one prayer I prayed those 29 months. God, take everything you need to take away from me. But please, 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 please don't take my mind from me. Don't take my smile. Don't take my joy. God, please let me keep my mind. And I just wanted to say thank you for that. And it was just such an amazing feeling to remember where I was when I first went to AIDS Project Los Angeles and where I am now with AIDS Project Los Angeles and Tiana and Brian, Elise, Phil, Valerie, Aaron, Jason, Ilana, Tanya, I think I said her name, who interviewed me today, and just realizing that when I do my peer support, I've got like this amazing system, this amazing people that I can say when I encounter people that are going through some of the same things I was going through, I don't have a I don't know for them. I have a, hey, let me call Tiana and see what we can do. Hey, let me talk to Brian and see what we can come up with. When people have problems with their doctors, I'm like, hey, you know what? Let me call my clinic and see what we can come up with. Or let me take you to my clinic and let them speak to you. So we can see what we can come up with. It's just full circle for me. Full circle for me. And then to get the interview today for The Optimist, it's just, I'm embracing my life. I'm loving and in love with my life. And I'm thankful for the journey and I'm thankful for the experience. Peace and blessings. Bye.